Hans Frei was born in 1922 to German Jewish parents in a city called Breslau, in what's now in modern Poland, was then in East Germany. His dad was a famous urologist. He devised a famous test for venereal disease, and his mother a paediatrician. They were Jews who for generations had been thoroughly assimilated into German cultural, intellectual and social life. Frei, therefore, was of a Jewish heritage and always remains aware of this, but nevertheless has been, as it were, as thoroughly immersed in the German tradition. Of course, he lived through a time when Germany was in a time of turmoil and during the period when the Nazis came to power. And so his parents, aware that to be an assimilated Jew constituted no safety in this period, had him sent to England in 1935. There he was warmly received at a Quaker college in Saffron Walden and seems to have undergone some kind of conversion experience. He and his parents then moved on to the United States in 1938, where they lived in New York in quite straitened circumstances and with his father in failing health. He died after a long illness. And in these conditions, Frei had to take really whatever was on offer in terms of education. So eventually he went and studied textiles in an obscure state university. There, however, he became active in the Christian Union there, but also heard a visiting theologian speak, Richard Niebuhr, a very famous American theologian at the time, one of two brothers, Richard and Reinhold. Richard Niebuhr really inspired Frei to take up theological training for himself, and so he went to Yale and did his Bachelor in Divinity. Subsequently, he went into the Baptist pastorate for a few years before deciding, after a long and agonising struggle, to return to Yale and to do a doctorate. So he went back to Yale and studied for quite some years under Niebuhr, writing a doctorate on the development of Karl Barth's doctrine of revelation and his break with liberal theology. Frei stayed at Yale, came back to Yale in the late 50s and stayed there for the rest of his career, teaching both in the divinity faculty and the religious studies departments and exercising a profound influence upon a whole several generations of students. He died in 1988 quite untimely and unexpectedly after complications following a stroke. There are a number of influences that converge in Frei and that kind of go into making the complex whole that is his developing thought as he writes throughout his life. Obviously, an enormous influence there is Karl Barth, both the early Barth, who Frei examines in his doctorate, but also as he goes on and reads the later volumes of Barth's Church Dogmatics. These begin to feed into Frei's very particular sensibility and understanding of the Christian faith. So Karl Barth exercises a huge influence in his Christocentrism, in his approach to the questions about historicity, in his view of providence and God's shaping of history. Then there's Richard Niebuhr, who directed his dissertation, and whose concern and interest in the story of Jesus in the Gospels and its importance for Christian faith and ethics. Also in his commitment to political theology, and to particularly to American political theology, and upholding a political theology which really held on to the sovereignty of God and his graciousness and his gracious complex involvement in the history of the nation, without identifying it with nationalism and yet without being able to withdraw back into sectarianism, a theme to which Frei returned at the very end of his life, and perhaps one of his important insights. In addition to Frei, Barth and to Niebuhr, then there's also the long tradition of German academic theology, which had also influenced Niebuhr and into which Frei read in great depth when writing on Barth and afterwards, and he lectured on these figures, people like Kant and Herder, Schleiermacher, Ritschl, and other figures in this long tradition. And in many ways, you can read Frei's work as a sustained response to the questions that this tradition threw up for the Christian faith in the modern period. Lastly, Frei drew eclectically on a range of more recent philosophical, literary critical, sociological and anthropological works. Figures like Wittgenstein, like Eric Auerbach, like Clifford Geertz and others, helped provide Frei with the concepts he needed to take forward the insights of Barthes, of Niebuhr, and address the questions that the 19th century tradition had left to him.
This illuminated timeline explores a fascinating relationship between Christian theology and modern thought from 1600 to the present day. It is both interactive and multimedia. If when exploring a particular period, text becomes illuminated, that will signify that there is additional resources on that topic to be revealed. By clicking that item, a page will appear with further information, often featuring video footage of expert commentary on that author's thought.
Norton has always traced the most important themes in his theology.
But in addition to these multimedia resources, this timeline has another layer, another dimension to it. If at the bottom left-hand corner of each page you press the button entitled Movements, many of the theological and philosophical movements of that period will appear. Again, some are interactive, revealing more multimedia resources. The layout of this timeline is not complex. At the top of each page, cultural and intellectual developments are listed, and at the bottom, chronologically parallel theological works and events are found. So overall, as you can see, there is so much to explore and discover in this illustrated, interactive and multimedia timeline of the fascinating relationship between Christian theology and modern thought.